How can we take a simple app and architect it so that it can cost over $2,000 per month? So a quick background here. When you're developing your application, you can literally do anything. All you need is a computer and a dream. But when you deploy your application, there's a lot of things that you have to consider just to get your application to work how you intend on it working. And these are things that you wouldn't usually have to do on your own computer and requires tons of configuration. We're gonna build an app that every tech YouTuber seems to love building. Task management software. So let's just keep it simple, okay? A front end and a back end for a task management system. Let's assume that this stays on your computer and you're the only user. Only user by choice, okay? So let's just draft up an application pretty quick. A web page that has different hard-coded categories that you can add tasks within it. I used Shad CN UI in order to create this little homepage and it looks pretty clean. It's what everyone seems to be using nowadays, so I just joined the bandwagon. Then let's just do a little Flask application written in Python. Since this is only being used by yours truly, I'll just store all of my data in a Python dictionary. That's at the top of the single file that it takes to make this. So creating a Docker compose file where I throw both of these containers together means I can see them side by side. So let's run. I mean, it's a to-do application at the end of the day. So if you want to hire me as your developer advocate for your company, my email is right here. Please send big bills. You can probably run this on your local machine, but you can also risk losing your data as soon as the Docker container stops. This could be for sure run for free on whatever cloud's free tier or just really your own machine. But I mean, we got to get our bread up here, so let's go. We need to add a couple more items to our architecture to make this actually usable for people. First, a database. Let's choose the GOAT, Postgres. Then we also need something that can proxy our server so that we don't have to point to a specific port or socket. So for that, we'll use Nginx. That means that we have to add a login screen to this so that you can have some privacy. So I'll just adjust my Flask application to have secured endpoints so that you have to be authenticated with a JWT. And then we just create a login and signup page in the React application and then just connect them together. Now to do all of this, I'm using Docker Compose, and Docker is actually the sponsor of today's video. If you're a developer and don't know about Docker, are you even on the internet? How are you even watching this video? Docker lets you package your software and dependencies in something called containers, which are isolated virtual machines that sit on top of the Docker engine. That way you get lightweight and consistent results no matter where you deploy or develop your app. Okay, so we open up the Docker Compose file, which lets us create a fleet of Docker containers and we'll add in Postgres and Nginx. Similar to a package manager like npm or pip, we can choose out a ton of different images that already exist, so we don't have to build our own images. We have this big Docker compose file in .yaml. Let's go and run Docker compose up because this is going to take a while probably. I mean, the app sort of looks the same, but underneath the hood, we have completely changed the infrastructure, which would actually be usable in a production environment. Now, usually in local development, you go to port 8000 or something, but now you can just go to localhost, and that's thanks to Nginx. I mean, imagine going to Google and you had to go to like google.com/8000 in order to just use the search. Roughly speaking, you could get close to using a free tier on a cloud or spending about, I don't know, like $30 or something. Very basic app. So let's add some more features. How many applications do you rely on that notifies you through a new event, through a text message, notification, email, whatever? Usually you'd use an external API service like Resend, since dealing with email is absolutely terrible, but we won't. We'll be implementing it all ourselves. Okay, I kind of lied. Really? I'm using an external SMTP server to power the emails, but what I really meant is implementing a queue system. So I wrote a script here that sends an email. Traditionally, your code would execute everything line by line, and if the email failed, you would get an error. But if everything else worked but the email, you would be confused when you go back and see the changes that were made we're successful. And this is exactly where queues come in. Rather than relying on the code executing successfully, you would pass it to a queue to do this for you. The success would only be in if the job successfully was given to the queue. So I'm gonna add in the new email worker, and I'll have it depend on RabbitMQ. Something else I wanna add into this to-do app is real-time functionality. By adding a WebSocket connection, we could get live updates across devices, or if we implement some sort of Teams feature or something. Then I could charge per seat. Man, I'm gonna be rich in no time. I added a WebSocket server in the Docker Compose file that will listen to events and interact with our database. To make things extremely fast though, we'll need to use a cache. Databases are really fast as is, but like, real-time fast is another level of fast. We would need to store in memory rather than on the disk. And so for this, we can use Redis. So we're gonna put this in the Docker Compose file. This far in the video, it seems funny how much we've added here in this file, but think about the software used in production environments for just a minute. As it grows, how do you create a stable dev environment that can be used by different developers? And this is why Docker makes a lot of sense, because you can create a dev environment almost instantly with the same tech stack that you use in your production environment. Something I'm also going to use is Docker Build Cloud. For my custom images that I'm making, so far there's four. Relying on my own computer to build, then push is annoying. So Docker Build Cloud lets you create parallel builds off your computer so you can use all of your compute resources for development. It also shares cache between different projects so you don't have to re-download dependencies or large artifacts. Overall, adding all this infrastructure puts a decent amount of costs into the application at the end of the day, almost past $100. Okay, let's test out the app. In order for us to actually know what's going on in our infrastructure, we need to take a look at logging and monitoring. And don't tune out, okay? This is actually really interesting stuff. For logging, we'll use the Elk stack, which consists of Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. And for monitoring, we'll use Prometheus and Grafana. When I went to visit a data center with over 90,000 different servers, I was able to see how they use a lot of these technologies, and it made everything look scary and complex. E, Elasticsearch, is used to search documents that are unstructured. L, Logstash, takes in the data from sources and manipulates it in whatever way you like. Kibana is a visualizer of this data. So, yes, that means we have to add three more items to our Docker Compose file, which for me is starting to get extremely overwhelming, but for you, this is just where the insanity continues and you get to have fun. I'll also make sure that our applications are all connected so that we can see the logs be taken in correctly. When you're starting to build a production infrastructure, you often hear horizontal scaling, which means that it's cheaper and easier to create two smaller machines than it is to create one bigger server. This is because it eliminates all the load going onto one server and allows flexibility when there's downtime. In Docker Compose, I can set a deploy key and put replicas in there. So let's create multiple replicas of some of our servers we made. And we're also going to update our Nginx configuration to determine what server to send this traffic to. We can do this by setting different weights. And if we total up all the assets that we use, we get close to $300, $400. Logging seems like a lot, but there's actually a lot of services underneath the hood that kind of makes it a consolidated service. To test this, let's run our Docker Compose file. This is way over-engineered as is, but we're at the final boss of over-engineering. Now, we're not just going to run our containers on these cloud providers and then go to sleep. Come on, that's amateur hour. Oh no, we're going Kubernetes. We're going full on Kubernetes. And to manage traffic across all of these data centers, we'll implement a global load balancing solution. We'll use a combination of cloud native solutions and a third-party service like Cloudflare for maximum control. Now, when our app is spread across the entire globe, data consistency, well, it becomes a challenge. We'll implement a multi-master database setup with real-time replication. Postgres logical replication feature will be our best friend here. We'll also set up a global caching layer using Redis, with cache invalidation mechanisms to ensure data consistency. It's also 2024, and like, if you don't have AI in your application, why are you even deploying it? So I'll build a serverless function, and I'll use smart task categorization, priority suggestion based on user behavior, natural language processing for task creation. Oh, our legal team is not happy whatsoever. We have to implement a strict government policy for some reason. We'll ensure GDPR, CCPA, TRSY, XYZ. I made those last two ones up, by the way. Let's expand our monitoring to distributed tracing with Jaeger, log aggregation with ElkStack deployed across all regions, custom dashboards in Grafana for real-time insights, automated alerting and incident response with PagerDuty integration. God, this is so stupid. And terrible news, a giant meteor just destroyed an entire data center. So we'll implement a comprehensive disaster recovery plan. We're talking multi-region backups, automated failover mechanisms, and regular disaster recovery drills. You can't make this up. Now, if you want to over-engineer your applications, then you have all the available resources to do so, and I really hope you do. Thank you to Docker for sponsoring today's video. I wouldn't be able to do all of this if it wasn't for Docker Compose orchestrating this entire mess, which I'm thankful for in a weird way.